all the kids to come forward. So kids of all ages, you're welcome to come up here. So please join me up front. So good, come on in and have a seat. Come on in, hi. Come on in and have a seat. You may come too. Yeah. Yep, you don't have to come, but it's great to have all the kids up here. Awesome. Kaden, it's your birthday? Kaden's birthday was yesterday and you were 5? Oh, okay, so can we sing to you? Yeah, so Kaden, right? All right, we're gonna sing happy birthday, okay?
Happy birthday to you,
Cookie Man.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Kaden. Happy birthday to you.
Well, we're thankful for you. Well, we're thankful for all of you. And this beautiful Easter morning, you all look very nice, by the way. We all Lent season have been talking about the idea of gardens, right? We've been talking about the problem of snakes and not enough water, garden identification, weeds, garden planning, and today we're talking about garden restoration. Do you know what it means to restore something? So if you're restoring a garden, do you know what it means? You're fixing it up, that's right. So there's something wrong with it, perhaps it's broken, and we're called to restore and fix that garden. So yesterday was such a beautiful day after the Easter Advent, I said to myself, you know what? I want to do some garden restoration for Easter. And if you didn't know, we have 13 acres here at Red Arrow, 10 of which are those back 10 acres, and those 10 acres are a mess. They look terrible. It's nothing but dirt and mud, and so I decided to turn the back 10 acres into a beautiful garden. So I wanted to document it, so we recorded a video to show you. If you could get the lights and please turn those on.
This Easter, I really need to get serious about restoring this broken world. I have been given new life in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, not only are we called to invest in the lives around us, but we are called to restore every square inch of this broken world and work to restore the Garden of Eden, expanding its boundaries to the very ends of the earth. So, I will begin with restoring this entire field, all 10 acres of it, by transforming it into a beautiful garden.
Time to do anything else to use that thing. I think you're right.
Maybe she's in the hall in the Weston area. Besides, why is she in here? Thank you.
Alright. Oh, okay. No, I didn't even have the right tools, but thankfully, I'm part of a great church where we have people with gifts and talents, and my friend Jim, he helped me out to realize there's no way I could do it by myself. We're talking about restoration of God's world today, and because Jesus rose from the grave on Easter, it changes everything. And one of his friends, Mary, was there that day, and she saw Jesus. She didn't recognize him. She thought he was the gardener. And as we're going to see in today's passage, that we are called to fix this broken world, but we're not called to do it on our own. That's why we have a great church where all of us could work together to bring new life into this world. So good job listening. Okay, here's the deal. Back up a little bit. These are the leftover candy bags from the Easter egg hunt. But listen, everybody gets one. There are still golden tickets throughout the bag. If you find a golden ticket after the service, Miss Renee has the leftover prizes, okay? So don't rush up here. Everybody gets one. Grab one bag of candy and you can return to your seats. If you are preschool through first grade, you can head to rest stop with Miss Renee. It's up to your mom and dad. So talk to them first. But again, preschool through first grade. While the kids are getting settled, please open up your Bibles to the book of John. We're going to be in chapter 20 this morning, starting with verse 1. So good job listening, kids. Hopefully you liked my dream of the back 10 there. We're excited about what God's going to do. All right, we need some more. We've got reinforcements. Like I said, I can't do this on my own. We need help from others. Again, thank you so much for being here this morning. One of our greatest privileges and honors is to have you join us on Easter morning. You could be doing a lot of things this morning. Heck, you could be restoring a garden in your backyard, but you chose to be here, and we're thankful for that, and we are very grateful. But if you've joined us this Lent season, we've been working through this series called Jesus, Name Above All Names. We're looking today at how Jesus is the risen Lord. John, if you can see the next slide. We've been using this great book by Alistair Begg and Sinclair Ferguson to look at numerous different aspects of both the work and the person of who Jesus is. Because in order for us to fully understand who Jesus is, we see lots of different biblical passages that show us the different aspects of why he is the Savior of the world. And so today, when we think about the risen Lord, we're going to be in the book of John. This is the Gospel of John. John, if you remember, was one of the disciples. And so he decided to sit down and give a first-person perspective of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And so when John's writing this gospel, as we're reading it, if he ever is present for an event, he'll write down the disciple that Jesus loved, or he'll say the other disciple. And whenever we read that, we know that John is physically there and he's referring to himself. But the scene is early on the first day of the week, Sunday morning. The sun is just about to peek over the horizon. Mary and some other women, we know from the other Gospels, rushed to the tomb just as the sun was coming up. And they were holding with them burial spices. They had run out of time on Good Friday when the sun went down, the Sabbath began, and they didn't fully prepare the body of Jesus. And so they were going to prepare and finally do what they had called to do. But you also have to remember their state of mind. They were overcome with grief. They were consumed in depression because they had just witnessed the death of their Lord. And so keep that in mind as we look at chapter 20, verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one who Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter, reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen there, as well as the burial cloth that he had been put around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separated from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. But they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb, crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "Well, they've taken away my Lord," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. "Woman, why are you crying?" he said. "Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him, cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell him, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God." Mary Magdalene went with the disciples and told the news, "I've seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. So many people throughout the year ask me, "Well, why is it that Red Arrow Ministries and many other Protestant churches worship on Sunday and not on the traditional Sabbath, which is Saturday?" And so the answer I always give is that we follow the first followers of Jesus. Friends like Mary and the disciples, who because of Easter Sunday, recognized the importance of this day, the first day of the week, and then shifted their worship from the Sabbath now to Sunday, which is how we're gathering here today. But in order for us to fully understand this particular passage, we have to get inside a bit the mind of Mary and the other followers of Jesus. Have you ever had something in your life so tragic, so horrifying, that you are paralyzed with grief? That you can't think straight, that you're so overwhelmed, you're not able to perceive what's going on around you? That is how Mary was feeling that morning, as she and the other women carrying the burial spices quickly rushed to the tomb. I'm sure they were filled with anxiety, thinking, how are we going to roll the stone away? Are we going to ask some of the guards that were supposed to be positioned there? I just can't believe Jesus is gone. And as they walked up, as the sun was coming up, imagine their shock. Imagine their terror when they walk up and they see the stone has been rolled away and the tomb is empty. Mary drops her spices and tears off to go tell the disciples, Peter and John. They, of course, as soon as they hear it, they go running to the tomb. Now remember, John was there and he is the other disciple whom Jesus loved. And we don't know if he's like a marathon runner or something. We don't know if he's more conscientious about his cardiovascular skills. But he tears off and he outruns Peter. Peter's kind of like, "Hey, wait for me." John's like, "No," and he comes tearing in. He arrives to the site first. Now if we could see that slide there. What he saw was something similar to this. We know that the tomb that Jesus was buried in was basically a cave that had been carved out of a rock face. And you see the stone was a circular stone that guards would roll into place and seal it. Now in the ancient world, grave robbers were actually pretty common because they would want to roll that stone away and pillage any of the valuables that was buried with the recently deceased person. So you can imagine why Mary was so upset, and she tells these men, he says, "Someone has taken my Lord and they don't know where they put them." Sure enough, when John arrives, he sticks his head in the tomb, not going all the way in, and he sees some strips of linen lying there. Then typical Peter, right, he comes running and pushes John out the way, jumps down and into the tomb. Not only does he see the linen, but he sees a burial cloth that has been around Jesus' head. And the cloth was folded up now, nice by itself. Now, if this was grave robbers, do you really think after they stole the body and they stole whatever else was in there, they said, "Oh, let's neatly fold the burial cloth. Oh, that's a good idea. Make sure you cross the seams and put..." Okay, that's... No! If it was really grave robbers, robbers, they wouldn't care to nicely fold the burial cloth, but that's what Peter saw. So clearly something was going on. After Peter got out, finally the other disciple, John himself, who had reached the tomb first, he also stepped down and in and went inside the tomb. And what did he see? He saw and believed. John is admitting here for his readers and for us that when he walked in and saw the linen and the burial cloth folded and the body of Jesus was gone, it kind of clicked in his head. And he said, oh, all of those times that Jesus said he had to die, he also said that to be the Messiah, he would also come back from the dead. If you were here on Thursday night, we celebrated Maundy Thursday, and we talked about the suffering that Jesus endured in the Garden of Gethsemane, at his arrest, at his trial, and at his crucifixion. And we see from the Old Testament scriptures that if for Jesus to be the true Messiah that God's people have been waiting for, he had to die, to give his life for you and for me. And in the same way, John points out, but some of the other disciples, parenthetically, you know, people like Peter and people like Thomas, people like Mary, they did not understand from scriptures that Jesus as the Messiah had to come back to life and rise from the dead. So the disciples went back to their homes, and we see Mary standing there outside the tomb crying. Have you ever wept so hard you can't breathe? Have you ever been crying for so many days that your eyes swell up and you can't see clearly? Imagine Mary weeping with every ounce of her, crying, not knowing where the body of Jesus has gone. She, of course, bends over, looks in the tomb, and what does she see? Two angels, one at the head of the stone table where Jesus was buried, and one at the foot. Not realizing that these are angels, she gets asked a question. Woman, why are you crying? These angels know that Jesus has come back from the dead. This is a time of celebration. Woman, why are you sad? Why are you depressed? Why are you crying? Don't you get it? Don't you understand? Don't you see what's happening here? And do you see what she says? Pretty much the same thing she said to the disciples. They've taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they've put him. Clearly, she couldn't even tell that those were angels. But it's important that we see the position of those angels. Can we see that next slide? If you were here during our garden planning sermon, where we talked about worship planning and how there's this pattern of worship in the Old Testament called the tabernacle. And when the followers of God in the Old Testament would go through this pattern, they get to the end of the tent and there'd be this veil. And past the veil, they'd go into the Holy of Holies where they'd see this Ark of the Covenant. And once a year, the high priest could go in there, and between the space, between those angels as they're outspread, is called the mercy seat. And that's where the presence of God dwelled among his people. And so there's significance here. If we can see the next slide. This placement of the angels on either end of the stone platform on which Jesus' body had been lying visually suggests the two cherubim on the Ark of the Covenant, their wings overshadowing the mercy seat. This is another expression that Jesus is God and has come out of the Holy of Holies to reveal himself to the world. So Mary doesn't see that they're angels and doesn't see the connection between the Ark of the Covenant and instead exits the tomb. And who does she see? She runs into Jesus. But she doesn't recognize him. She doesn't see that it's him. Maybe it's because her eyes are so swollen from crying. Maybe it's because she's overwhelmed with grief and isn't thinking straight. Or maybe the body of Jesus, now that it's been resurrected, we see in other passages, it might look a little bit different than what they had remembered. I mean, the guy's been dead for 3 days, now he's back to life. I would think he would look a bit better than he did a few days ago. And so Mary did not recognize him, and is looking at him and doesn't realize, and so Jesus asks, woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for? And there it is, thinking he was the gardener. Could you imagine the King of Kings and Lord of Lords being mistaken for the gardener? Sir, again, she's singularly focused on preparing the body of Jesus still. Sir, if you, now blames this guy, if you have carried him, tell me where you've put him and I will get him. Now, if you've ever gone through trials in your life, if you've ever suffered loss, maybe the loss of a loved one, a parent, a child, you know the grief that consumes you. You know how you can't think straight. But you also know that there's one remedy. There's one solution that cuts through all of that. And that is when the voice of Jesus calls out our name. And we see that occur for Mary. All Jesus had to do, like a good shepherd calling out the name of his sheep, he looks at her and says, Mary. And immediately it clicks. She sees that it's Jesus, and she throws herself at his feet, grabbing onto his legs. You can imagine him almost probably falling, saying, whoa, Mary, what are you doing? And strangely, he says, do not hold on to me. Aren't we supposed to hold on to Jesus? But yet, what's he mean here? From now you return to the Father. And I like how one commentator explains this. Very helpful. Mary was hanging on to him for dear life because she thought that she had lost him, but now she had him back. So he said, it's okay. Mary, I'm not leaving yet. We still have some more time. I'm going to come and be with the disciples. I'm going to be with you for 40 days or so. You don't have to hold me captive. And Mary obeys the word of the Lord, goes to the disciples and says, I've seen the Lord, and tells them everything that he has said. And so as we bring this Lent season to conclusion, as we come full circle, really, from where we began. If you were here at the very beginning, we talked about the Garden of Eden and everything that happened in there. And each and every message, there was a tie-in with this idea of a garden. I want to read for you probably the most powerful part of this book. We're going to close here in a section called The Gardener Returns. You need to recall what Adam was created to be, the gardener. Everything God made was good, but everything was not yet gardened. God wanted Adam to exercise his dominion by expanding the garden. Having given him a garden to begin with, God was saying, now, Adam, I've given you a start. Just as we might say to our children, here is a start, now you go and do the rest. Adam was to garden the whole earth for the glory of the Heavenly Father. But he failed. Created to make the dust fruitful, he himself became part of the dust. The Garden of Eden became the wilderness of the world. But do you also remember how John's Gospel records what happened the morning of Jesus' resurrection? Mary Magdalene did not recognize him. Instead, she spoke to him, supposing him to be the gardener? Well, who else would he be at that time of the morning? The gardener? Yes, indeed. He is the gardener. He is the second man, the last Adam, who is now beginning to restore the garden. Later that day, Jesus showed his disciples where the nails and the spear had drawn blood from his hands and side. The serpent had indeed crushed his heel, but he had crushed the serpent's head. Now he was planning to turn the wilderness back into a garden. Soon he would send his disciples into the world with the good news of his victory. All authority on earth lost by Adam was now regained. The world must now be reclaimed for Jesus, our risen Lord. And so as you think back to the children's sermon, if you think back, well, what in the world was Ben doing out there with 10 acres and a little garden tool that he got at Ace Hardware? There's no possible way that I could have done that, right? And I'll admit, it was pretty extreme. But as I've said in the past, that Easter Sunday changes everything. And because of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus, we should have this extreme change in our life where we move away from selfish desires and then understand that we're supposed to invest in the lives of the people around us. And as we saw in that section, as we saw in this passage, we are called to garden, to restore this beautiful, broken world. But like I tried to illustrate with the kids, there's no way I could do it by myself. I was a fool to think I could spend 10 acres worth of soil out there and go. I would have had a heart attack and someone else would be preaching today. But this is the beauty of what Jesus came to do. Because he said to Mary, Mary, don't hold on to me. It's not saying that a personal relationship with Jesus is not important. It's vitally important. But when Jesus was saying, Mary, I didn't just die for you and come back to life. I'm here also for the disciples and also for the people of Eastern Van Buren County and Kalamazoo and Southwest Michigan. That's who I died and came back to life for. And so in the same way that I could not garden those 10 acres, none of us could walk this journey alone. And that's why being part of a faith community like a church is so vitally important. Because I don't have all the gifts and talents needed to do it. But together as one body, we all, with our unique gifts, talents, farming equipment. We can get it done. And so if you're here today and you hear the voice of our Lord saying your name, I would love to pray with you after the service and introduce you to the gardener. Please pray with me now. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for what you did for us on the cross. And Lord, we are here to celebrate your resurrection. Lord, thank you for conquering the powers of sin and death, and thank you for calling us to new life. Lord, when we look at the mess of this world and we understand we need to restore it, Lord, it's overwhelming because we think we could do it on our own. But Lord, you call us to live in a faith community, partnering together with your Spirit, leading the way to restore this beautiful world. Lord, help us to do that. Help us to find our place, not only in this church, but in your kingdom purposes. Lord, we're here to celebrate, and we thank you for what you did for us. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.